Good morning, everybody. Welcome to a beautiful morning. Let's praise God, hey?
I think you should get them to clap, Jess.
Oh. All my life, all I know, God's been good, good to my soul. Mountain high, valley low, I'm gonna sing wherever I go. Come on, let's get the clap going. You know this song. Get some boot scooting going on. Big country for ya. Well, who knows that God is on the move. That's the song of this one, the name of this song. It's a great song. It's a bit of a driving song. I don't know if you've got that yet, but we want to get you to bust a move. Break out of that four walls, you know.
Heart turns from darkness to light. Anytime temptation comes and stands to fight. Anytime somebody says to serve and not be served. I know. God is on the move. Hallelujah, hallelujah. God is on the move in many mighty ways. God is on the move, on the move. Someone falls upon their knees, or dares to speak the truth that sets men free. Anytime the choice is made to stand upon the word, I know God is on the move, hallelujah, God.
anytime the gospel stirs a searching soul. And someone says, me, here I go. Father.
Yes, Lord, we praise you this morning that you are truly alive and that you're on the move and you're here in the Riverland working and doing things. Isn't that cool? That's cool. Well, just quickly, I want to tell you some things that are going on around the place. You can sit down if you like, but I'm going to make you stand up again in like 20 seconds. So, you know, up, down, up, down, up, down. That's all good. I'm Joella. Welcome to building this morning. It's great to have you here. It's great to see some faces I don't recognize. I'm looking forward to meeting you afterwards, and that'll be great. We have tea and coffee afterwards in the room next door here, so there's an opportunity to get to know some people, to say hello and have something to eat, let's be honest. But I just wanted to welcome you this morning. Welcome if you're watching from the next room or if you're on live stream. It's great to have you with us. This morning, this is all about us encouraging one another, all about us worshiping God together. This is all about, you know, we get to be church all week long. We get to be the children, the people of God all week long. And your major ministry probably doesn't happen here in this building. It probably happens in your workplace, in your classroom, online, wherever you are through the week is where Jesus is using you to do amazing things. At least that's my prayer. And so this morning we're here to encourage each other, to spur each other on, to say, yes, we can do this. We can serve a great God who will work through you this week. So that's not church news. That's my excitement and my passion this morning, that we would be God's people spread out across this region, spread out across this state this week doing God's will. But anyway, there's some other things to talk about. Today we have our women's Bible reading group meeting at 12:30. No, we don't. Today we don't have our women's Bible reading group meeting at 12:30. On Wednesday night, we do have our Zoom prayer meeting at 7:30. Yes, we do. All right. Excellent. If you don't know how to connect to that, have a chat with David. This is him. This is the David. He's come this way so the live stream people can see you. Live stream people, have a chat with this David after the service today, after the meeting. Beautiful. And Friday night, we have G1 Youth Connect Groups. Woohoo! If you're not so sure about that, have a chat with, I'm going to say, Michaela. Why don't you stand up, stand up, stand up. Pirouette, beautiful. This is Michaela. Excellent. If you have never been baptized, the time is coming soon when you can do that. So please have a chat with David or I. If you've never been baptized, but you love Jesus and you've given your life to him and you want to follow him all the days of your life, have a chat with us, because being baptized in water is the next step for you. So have a chat with us and we can make that happen over the next little while. And also just a reminder that we have our little free pantry out on the veranda, way down the other end there. There's a little box, a little cupboard. People come and use that nearly every day. Well, probably more than once every day. Lots of people come and looking to see whether there's something in there for them, some food. So if you would like to give, we know that there are people in our community really struggling at the moment and really fearful about what Christmas is going to look like for them in this particular situation of their life. And if we can give them some hope and some generosity and some love by means of a tin of baked beans or, you know, something, then let's do that. So please keep giving into the little free pantry. You can just pop things in there. If it's full, bring it on a, you know, to other time when the building's open, the people here, and we can store it and then slip it out through the week as it empties out. But I said it was going to be time to stand up in 30 seconds or so let's do that. Kids church is on today. We're going to be heading out that way. round the back. We're going to be making lots of noise here while you guys continue to sing, so we'll out-noise you if we can. You hopefully will hear us, and we'll hear you for sure. So we'll be doing that, but we're going to go out right now as everybody else stands up, and we're going to have 90 seconds to say g'day to somebody, introduce yourself, give them a high five, an elbow bump, whatever it is seems appropriate. Otherwise, you know, sit with your head between your knees if you don't want to talk to anybody. But 90 seconds, your time starts now.
Good morning. Again, time has gone off. Bang. So, I don't know what the timer leads to, but I think it leads to less talking, I think. Does it? Well, yeah. Welcome to everyone again. My name's Steve Menadue. I'm just going to lead us in a time of communion this morning. And yeah, for that, so everyone's got their little thing here. And so all communities is just a time for people that love Jesus is to get together and just share anything. Today it's just a little bit of grape juice and a wafer, but if you really want to stretch it, you could actually share any sort of a meal or something together, those that come in his name, and to remember what he's done for us. So this morning I'm just going to talk about the biblical phrase of standing firm. Now, recently Benjamin and I have been watching the start of a television series, SAS Australia, and we've tried to persevere, but we've sort of fallen away because we just can't stand the adverts, and I can't find another version without adverts, so we weren't all that committed. However, this sort of thing intrigues me a little bit, is that it shows a group of people from all different backgrounds thrown together, put under physical and psychological pressures to see who can last. And it's all for our entertainment. Obviously, this entertainment mimics the real thing. And since the end of the Second World War, several nations have developed small, specialised groups of military personnel. And what I find intriguing is when selecting people for these specialised roles, they don't select the best. What they're actually looking for is what they call the grey man or the grey woman. These are individuals that don't run the fastest or the longest, don't lift the heaviest, and are not the smartest. They're not the traditional best. Instead, they are the ones that are often in the top 75% of the groups in most challenges. Now, when the business end of the course approaches, the best and the worst of the group are often weeded out by the ever-increasing challenges that are combined with the long exposure to extreme fatigue, injuries, hunger, extreme and prolonged exposure to the elements. While suffering and digging deep within themselves for the motivation to carry on, they're also subjected to complex problem-solving and teamwork exercises. Eventually, they end up with individuals known as the grey men and women, those that have continued plodding along when they reach what they thought was their physical and mental limits, and were able to continue on, whereas the majority of us were not able to. Now, I think people are called grey because they don't stand out, they blend in. They just go quietly about their challenges without drawing attention to themselves. Now, imagine these people, the so-called grey men and women, there is a certain stubbornness, the ability to stand firm under challenging circumstances. And funnily enough, standing firm is a strong biblical principle. There are multiple references in the New Testament to standing firm. And if you ever want to get a picture of standing firm from a physical perspective, perhaps picture this. A person can be standing up, feet close together, head down, looking at their phone sort of thing. And if someone was to come up and push me over, don't do it, says you. And that you'd overbalance pretty easily and you'd go over. Whereas if you had like a stance of standing firm that's like more like this, your feet are spread apart, your weight's distributed, your torso's forward, your arms out, and you're scanning and ready for those threats. If someone went to push me over now, what's their chances? Like, you could do it, but you know, don't. And so that's like a physical. But what I want to draw it to is that spiritual way of standing firm. And so all through the Bible, we learn of the men and women of God standing firm and standing up to challenges. As the Bible tells us about God's people, it unfortunately tells us of some that didn't stand up to the challenges that they encountered. But the other side is that there are many, many people of faith that did stand up and stand firm for their faith. Paul the Apostle mentions standing firm in the faith many times, and one example is in 1 Corinthians 15:58. Therefore, my dear brothers, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labour is not in vain. So, of course, the greatest example of the one who stood firm is Jesus. Jesus faced the biggest challenges ever thought of. Jesus stood up, stood firm, and defeated the powers of darkness. Jesus allowed himself to be killed to pay the penalty for our sin, where we've fallen short of our Creator's expectations. He did this because God loves us so much and wants us to be in a relationship with Him that He sent His Son to live amongst us as a man, to experience the same life that we all do as common people, and then allow Himself to be killed to pay the penalty. And of course, the good news is that Jesus defeated death. Hallelujah. He rose again, and this means that we can be in relationship with Him, and I am very grateful for this. So we gather here at this time to worship our Creator and to share in the time of communion and to remember for what Jesus did for us, because He loved us so much. So going back to the Bible again, another passage mentions that the Lord Jesus, on the night He was betrayed, took the bread. It's like to stand now and undo the little packets. So Jesus, He took the bread, and when He had given thanks, He broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for me. Do this in remembrance of me." Let's take this together. And in the same way, after supper, He took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." Let's drink and remember. Yes, dear Lord, I just thank you that we can meet together as a community of people that knows and loves you. Thank you that we can remember what you've done for us and that we'll be forever grateful. And I just pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you for that, Steve. That was great. We're going to enter into some more time with worship today. And how about when we're thinking about this standing firm, that we also think about the fact that we're not living for today. We're not living for our circumstances that are right in front of us, but we're living because there's a tomorrow. Yeah. There's more to come in Him, and we know that we've got hope. We've got faith because our God is powerful and He promises things that are good for us, not to harm us, but to give us a hope and a future. So this next song we've got is More to Come, because who knows that there's more to come in Him, yeah? And that's part of being able to stand firm, is that we know that there's more to come, and therefore we are not giving out without a fight, yeah? I encourage you to stand up. Let's worship our God.
You're the God who makes the giants fall. You bring down the walls of Jericho. You're the God who gives the miracle. We believe. You're the God who puts the oceans wide, just to bring us closer to your side. You're the God who brings the dead to life. We believe, oh, we believe. God, how great you are, great things you have done. For everything we've seen, there is more to come. Every victory in every battle won. For everything we've seen, there is more to come. We are confident in all your ways, 'cause we know you never make mistakes. God, you fill us with a greater faith. We believe, yeah, we believe. And God, how great you are.
Put our hope in Him.
And all of our hope in, all of our trust in, all of our future is God, how great you are. Great things you have done. For everything we've seen, there is more to come. In every victory and every battle won, for everything we've seen, there is more to come. God, how great you are.
You to keep your eyes closed. Don't worry about the song. Don't worry about the words. Just meet with your Heavenly Father. Let Him show you what's more to come. Let Him show you the victory that He's already given to you. Let Him show you those holes in His hands where He has already taken what troubles you to the cross. Let's spend some time with our God, just one-on-one. Let's feel His Holy Spirit strengthening us, comforting in us. Thank you, Father. There is more to come. Ooh, oh, Jesus. As a mustard seed, nothing is impossible for our God. Yeah, thank you, Lord. Thank you for your promises, Lord God. Amen.
This is my worship. This is my offering. In every moment, I withhold nothing. I'm learning to trust you, even when I can't see it. And even in suffering, I have to believe it. If you say it's wrong, then I'll say no. If you say release, I'm letting go. If you're in it with me, I'll begin. When you say to jump, I'm diving in. If you say be still, then I will wait. If you say to trust, I will obey. I don't wanna follow my own way. I'm done chasing feelings. Spirit, lead me. A burden, but once I could grasp it, you took me further than I was asking. And simply to see you, it's worth it all. My life is an altar, let your fire fall. If you say it's wrong, then I'll say no. If you say release, I'm letting go. If you're in it with me, I'll begin. When you say to jump, I'm diving in. If you say be still, then I will wait. If you say to trust, I will obey. Teach me how to follow in your way. I'm done chasing feelings. Spirit, lead me.
Yes, Lord, we want to be led by you, Holy Spirit. We know that so often our own thoughts and our own desires, they lie to us. They tell us things that aren't true. And so this morning, God, we just submit ourselves to you again. We submit ourselves to your way. We submit ourselves to your plans and to what you would have us do. And we ask, Jesus, that you would come and you would remind us about who we really are. You see, we're not just people who are born by accident and go through a miserable life and die, and then we're snuffed out like we were never here. We're people who were created with a purpose by you. We're people who are created in the image of God. We're people who when we die will be promoted to an eternal glory if we are in Christ, if we are following you, Jesus, if we are known by you, and if we love you. So Lord God, we just pray right now you would remind us of who we are and you would remind us of who you are. And we ask that in Jesus' name. Amen? Amen. Hey, you can take your seats. It is really, really good to see you this morning. For those of you I haven't met before, if you've been around for a few weeks and I haven't met you, my name's Dave. I'm one of the pastors here. I've been away for 4 weeks. I know. You've wondered why it's been so much better around here. I've been away for 4 weeks, and Joella and I have been actually up in Queensland. We've been on holidays, and we started out our holidays. I'll show you what this is all about in a moment. But before I do that, I particularly just want to thank a few people who did a few things just to keep the church going while we were away. I'm just so thankful that we have a church of people. It's not all about the pastor. It's not all about just supporting a ministry. It's about so much more than that. And so I particularly want to thank people like Sarah and people like Emma and people like Michelle over here and Scott who led and preached in all kinds of ways. There's a whole heap of other people too who did some things. But just so thankful for them. So thankful for what they did to feed the church spiritual food as things went on. So thank you so much. A special thank you, of course, to Emma, who just oversaw everything and led really well. You didn't see a whole heap of what she did, but she just kept things ticking away. So I'm just super thankful that we had the chance to get away. We started our holidays by attending the first ever Exponential Australia conference, which was held in Robina. In Queensland, just off the Gold Coast, so that was pretty tough. And what that was about was a church planting conference. Exponential Australia, they have formed because they've realised what the state of church is, what the state of Christianity is in Australia. And they know that one of the ways of turning the tide of people moving away from Christ is to plant new churches. So they're not a church planting movement, they're not a denomination of their own, but they see themselves as a catalyst to see churches planted. And it was really exciting because there was over 600 leaders there and over 23 denominations or networks represented, so had a really great ecumenical feel. And I came away from that conference feeling incredibly inspired and with a sense of hope about where the church in Australia could be in the next few years. There was a real sense that, there's enough people going, the tide's got to turn, something's got to change. And so I came away incredibly inspired, incredibly hopeful about how things could be for the church in a few years' time. Yeah, exactly. I'm hopeful about it. And the other thing it actually did for me, we've been talking about church planting for a while as a local church. And what it did for me is it showed me that we are on the right track. We are on the right track. The current thrust is that churches need to be multiplying. Churches need to be replicating themselves. Churches need to be birthing other churches. And we've been talking about that, and I know there were probably a few people saying, oh, what does that mean for us? What's the cost going to be? Does that mean the pastors are going to leave and all this kind of stuff? I've got to tell you, I don't know where we're going to plant a church. I don't have a sense of the location. I don't know what kind of model we're going to use and what that's going to look like. I don't even know what the cost is going to be to our local church around that. I don't know if we're going to be part of the team that goes, or if some of you are going to be part of the team that goes and we'll stay behind. I don't know any of that. But what I know is that we need to be involved in church planting in some way. We need to be replicating ourselves. One of the things I did see at this conference was there was a whole heap of city churches who were replicating, and the focus seemed to be very city-centric. I want to tell you, regional people need Jesus. Country people need Jesus. And country people need an experience of a strong and healthy church that's inspiring and that's encouraging. And just because we live in the country doesn't mean we should miss out on that stuff, you know, on a great church. And I don't know about you, but I think we're doing pretty good as a church. You know, as far as country churches go, we're probably up there as healthy as any is by God's grace. Nothing because of us, but because of who God is and how he's blessed our church. We are worth replicating. We are worth multiplying. And let's jump on that, and let's be proud in a good way of who we are as people and recognize what we hold, and let's prepare for that multiplication process. Is that okay? I'm excited about that. I'm excited about that. I hope that you'll come on this journey with us as we prepare. Once again, I don't know when, I don't know where, I don't know how, I don't know the cost, but I know we got to do it. I know we got to do it. So let's get ready for that. If you're with me in this, if you sense, oh yeah, that's something I'd like to be involved in some way, shape or form, whether you're someone who's going to go or whether you're someone who's actually going to stay but sew in, can you stand with me? Because I want us to pray together just about the future of church in Australia. Thank you. Thank you. Let's pray together. Lord God, we want to thank you that even though church in Australia has been really, really difficult and really, really unhealthy in recent years, you don't give up on the church. You love the church. And anybody who says that the church is going to hell in a handbasket, they don't understand that the church is the bride of Christ. And you know, you can't love you, Jesus, and hate your wife. You can't love you and just dismiss your bride. And so, God, we want to thank you for churches. We want to thank you for the thrust of people who are changing or recognizing that there's a struggle and changing. And Lord, we know that we want to be involved in this too. We want to be involved in replicating who we are so that country people can know Jesus and so that country people can have a great experience of church, a great experience of growing together with brothers and sisters in Christ. And Lord, we know that when churches plant, people get saved. That's the reality. That's the reality. So God, we don't know what, where, when, or how, but we ask that you use us. We ask that you would trust us, God, that you would use us and that you would equip us. You would show us where we're to plant. You'd show us the right time. And for those people, God, who are standing right now, I pray that you would show them the part that they have to play in this as well. Whether that's to go and to pioneer something, or whether that's to stay and step up and to fill some of the holes that are left behind as people go. Whatever that is, God, we just pray right now your blessing on that whole enterprise. And we pray for churches around Australia that are multiplying right now, that are planting other churches. And we pray your blessing on them. We're not in any sort of competition with them, God. We're all the church together. We're all family together. And we pray your blessing on them now in Jesus' name. Amen? Amen. Amen. Great. You may take your seat. If you're brave, you can turn to the person next to you and say, I'm replicating. That might feel really awkward, I don't know. But some of you are glad you're not sitting with anybody right now. Hey, I, as well as that bit of news, I've got another bit of news for you this morning, and I'm going to ask Georgina to come on up. So those of you who know Georgina will know what an incredibly special and loved person she is. Georgina has been a part of Riverland Central Church this year. She came up here on student placement. She's a medical student. What year is it this year?
Third year.
Third year this year. So she doesn't have her stethoscope on her today. But Georgina's actually come to the end of her year, and she's returning back to Adelaide for the rest of her studies, We're going to farewell her today, but Georgina's got a couple of things she wants to say. So can we just have another microphone there? That'd be great. So I'm going to hand over to Georgina, and then we're going to pray for her, and we're going to bless her as she goes.
I haven't had a chance to finish writing this, but exactly what Dave was saying. So I'm finishing up for the year, going back to Adelaide, but I just want to thank everyone in the church for welcoming me to be part of your church community. And for like loving on me this past year. I feel very blessed and encouraged by all of you, and really encouraged by your love for God and love for others, and not just in this area, like in the Riverland, but everywhere in the world. So yeah, thank you. You've had such a positive impact on my year up here in the Riverland. So much love to you all, and may God continue to bless the work that you're doing up here.
Isn't she beautiful? Wait, don't go away. We love Georgina very much, and I'm sure anybody who knows her just knows what a what incredibly kind person she is, and the way she's just constantly connecting with other people. So we want to bless her. We want to just farewell her well. So why don't you just extend your hands towards her, and we're just going to pray blessing on you as you go back to Adelaide. Lord Jesus, we want to thank you so much for Georgina. We want to thank you so much for the just incredible person she is and the incredible life that you've given her. We thank you, Lord, that she loves you with all of her heart, and we thank you, God, that you love her incredibly as well. And we just pray blessing on Georgina now as she returns to Adelaide. We pray blessing on her studies. We pray blessing on her future career in the medical field. And we pray, God, that she would grow in her love for you. She would grow in her commitment to you. And she would hear from you really, really well in these coming years. So we bless her and we release her, and we just say thank you for sharing her with us in this last year, in Jesus' name. Amen?
Thank you.
Be blessed.
Thank you.
Be blessed. So make sure you get to say a proper goodbye to Georgie as she heads off today. It's her last Sunday with us, which sucks. But that's okay. That's okay. Well, as I said, it's been four Sundays since I've stood here, and from the outset, I just want to say it's an incredible privilege to stand before you and to preach the Word of God. That's something I never want to take for granted. That's something I never want to just sort of get in the groove and assume. I always feel this incredible sense of privilege and this incredible sense of inadequacy as I stand and preach, which is good, because it's not about me, it's about the Lord. Amen? Amen. So a couple of weeks ago, Emma started off our new preaching series. We called it Moving Forward, and it's all about focusing in on the first few chapters of Joshua. And those first few chapters of Joshua are all about the Israelites preparing to enter into the promised land. They've been wandering around the wilderness for a whole generation, wandering around in the desert as nomads, and they're about to enter into the promised land. Now, this is the fulfillment of a 700-year promise from God. Who here has seen every promise from God fulfilled in their life so far? Who's waiting for something? Some of you are waiting for something? Yep, you might be waiting for a husband or a wife. You might be waiting for children. You might be waiting for a house or a home. You might be waiting for all kinds of things. Has anyone been waiting for 700 years? Does it feel like 700 years? All right, so the Israelites had been waiting for 700 years until this point, where they were about to enter the promised land. That's faith, isn't it? Just hanging on to that thing, believing for that thing, even dying and not seeing that thing come to pass, but the next generation picks it up and carries it. Waiting, waiting, waiting. 700 years. Now, these Israelites, finally, they were in transition. They were not just from the desert to the promised land. They were also in transition from being nomads through to becoming established, through to becoming from wandering through to settling. And just like a transition requires a different way of life, so just like a transition requires you to put away the sleeping bags, it requires you to put away the camp stove if you're going to move from being a nomad, and suddenly you're in this dwelling place. You're in this place where you're spending late nights setting up IKEA furniture. Has anybody ever done that? Set up IKEA furniture. It always takes longer than you think. because you end up with all of these just miscellaneous shapes and they give you one Allen key. What is the deal with that one Allen key? And it's really short and it hurts your fingers when you're using it. And the instructions are so stupid. They make no... Sorry. I'm just venting my spleen here. And suddenly it's the middle of the night and you're going, when am I going to have this shelf finished? It's just dumb. Anyway, a transition like this from nomad to settler, it requires a change of mind. It requires a change of mindset. Some of the ways that of thinking and living when you're a nomad, they suddenly don't work when you settle, when you have a permanent home, and when you farm. It requires a change of mind. And for you older people among us, and older people is anyone over 50 because I'm not there yet, you know the importance of trying to keep your body flexible throughout your life. You know the importance of looking after your body because it starts to seize up as you get older. It's actually a challenge to keep your mind flexible as well, to allow your mindsets to change over your lifetime. And we all need to be prepared to change our mind. We all need to be prepared to change our values, to take on a different way of thinking, because sometimes the thinking pattern that I've got now, it doesn't work in 5 years' time. It doesn't work in 10 years' time. So we need our mindsets to stay flexible, amen? And the reason we're working our way through Joshua is because we're preparing to move into our new space. Into our new renovation. Now, I just want to show you a couple of photos. This is what the building looks like as of Friday. So the flooring guys have been in. They've put down the new floors. They've put down the new carpets. You can think, why aren't we in here right now? Well, there's a whole bit of cabling that still needs to happen. And we don't have a certificate of occupancy. We do have a council staff member here today. He would know if we jumped in there. So it's all coming together. It's all looking amazing. But the thing is, the way we dwell now, it's not going to work. When we get into this new space, we have to have some new mindsets. I am super thankful for some people who have put this together. People like Brian Huckle up the back. None of this would have happened without Brian and without his dogged, persistent efforts. Incredible, incredible. People like Coop, incredible slaves who just worked and worked and worked and worked at this thing. And there are other people like Alan and like Dave Morford and Josh and all these. Yeah, let's clap them as well. I mean, and anybody else who's helped in any way, shape or form around this, this wouldn't have happened without you. This would not have happened without you. So we can see that in just a very short amount of time, things are going to be different. And we can't just have a, well, build it and they'll come mentality. Because church is about so much more than a building. You know, probably even fair enough to say church isn't even a building. It's just a resource. This isn't the church. We are the church. This is just a resource that God is gifted us with, able to share Jesus with people. But the truth is that we're all going to have to grow and change some mindsets in order to steward well this incredible resource that God has given us. So today we're going to pick up the account in Joshua chapter 2, if you've got your Bible with you. If you have a Bible, either a paper or on your device, you can do that, but it will be on the screen as well. And today's message is called Unlikely. It's called Unlikely. Let's pray. Lord God, as we open your word, we know that it is alive and active. We know that your word it's actually dangerous to read it because when we read it properly, it changes who we are. And so God, as we read your word, the Bible, we actually pray a gutsy prayer right now that your word would change us, that it would change our mindsets, that it would change our hearts, that it would show us those parts of ourselves that are not in line with following you. But it would also encourage us with those parts of us that are in line with following you. So change us, we pray, Holy Spirit, as we read your word in Jesus' name. Amen? Amen. Okay, so we're picking up in Joshua chapter 2 from verse 1. It says, "Then Joshua secretly sent out two spies from the Israelite camp at Acacia Grove. He instructed them, 'Scout out the land on the other side of the Jordan River, especially around Jericho.' So the two men set out and came to the house of a prostitute named Rahab and stayed there that night. But someone told the king of Jericho, 'Some Israelites have come here tonight to spy out the land.' So the king of Jericho sent orders to Rahab, 'Bring out the men who've come into your house, for they have come here to spy out the whole land.' Rahab had hidden the two men and she replied, 'Yes, the men were here earlier, but I didn't know where they were from. They left the town at dusk as the gates were about to close. I don't know where they went. If you hurry, you can probably catch up with them.' Actually, she'd taken them to the roof and hidden them beneath bundles of flax she'd laid out. So the king's men were looking out for spies along the road leading to the shallow crossings of the Jordan River. And as soon as the king's men had left, the gate of Jericho was shut. Before the spies went to sleep that night, Rahab went up onto the roof to talk with them. 'I know the Lord's given you this land,' she told them. 'We're all afraid of you. Everyone in the land is living in terror. For we've heard how the Lord made a dry path for you through the Red Sea when you left Egypt. And we know what you did to Sihon and Og, the two Amorite kings east of the Jordan River, whose people you completely destroyed. No wonder our hearts have melted in fear. No one's the courage to fight after hearing such things. For the Lord your God is the supreme God of the heavens above and the earth below. Now, swear to me by the Lord that you'll be kind to me and to my family since I've helped you. Give me some guarantee that when Jericho's conquered, you'll let me live along with my father and mother, my brothers and sisters and all their families. We offer our own lives as a guarantee for your safety,' the men agreed. 'If you don't betray us, we'll keep our promise and be kind to you when the Lord gives us this land.' Then, since Rahab's house was built into the town wall, she let them down by a rope through the window. 'Escape to the hill country,' she told them. 'Hide there for 3 days from the men searching for you. Then, when you've returned, you can go on your own way.' Before they left, the men told her, 'We'll be bound by an oath we've taken only if you follow these instructions. When we come into the land, you must leave this scarlet rope hanging from the window through which you let us down. And all your family members, your father, mother, brothers, and all your relatives must be here inside the house. If they go out into the street and are killed, it won't be our fault. But if anyone lays a hand on people inside this house, we will accept the responsibility for their death. If you betray us, however, we're not bound by this oath in any way.' 'I accept your terms,' she replied. And she sent them on their way, leaving the scarlet rope hanging out of the window. The spies went up into the hill country and stayed there for 3 days. The men who were chasing them searched everywhere along the road, but they finally returned without success. Then the two spies came down from the hill country, crossed the Jordan River, and reported to Joshua all that had happened to them. 'The Lord has given us the whole land,' they said, 'for all the people of this land are terrified of us.'" So this is an amazing story, isn't it? It's got all kinds of elements. It's got secrets, it's got spies, it's got mystery, it's got sex, bargains, negotiations. It's got fencing, fighting, torture, revenge, giants, monsters. Oh, sorry, I was getting a bit excited there. That was the Princess Bride. And you might be thinking, what on earth has this got to do with me? What has a story like this got to do with modern life in Australia in 2023? You're saying we need to change our mindsets. What on earth can we learn from a story like that? Well, let's unpack it together. Let's unpack three different ways of thinking that we need to make sure that we have embraced, we have nailed down, we have got sorted as we move into this next stage of our church and as we interact with our community. Let's look at three different things. Here's the first one. Bigger's not always better. That's the first one. Bigger is not always better. I mean, think of the scene. There's Joshua, and he's got the entire nation of Israel behind him, and he's standing on the border of the promised land. He's looking across into this land of milk and honey that God has promised. And he's got a nation of more than 2.5 million people behind him. They're ready to go. They've been waiting 700 years to enter into this thing. And what does he do? He sends in two people. He sends in two people secretly to spy out the land. I don't know about you, but if that was me, I would have just got the biggest, toughest, ugliest blokes I'd got and just barrel through. They are ready to go, they're trained, they're eager, they're keen, but he sends in two people. Bigger's not always better. Joshua understands that sometimes it's better to start small. Sometimes it's better, smaller is actually more powerful, smaller is wiser. When we were away on holidays, we went to the Exponential Conference up in Queensland, and then Joella and I in our car made our way down the East Coast. We spent a couple of weeks coming down the East Coast as far as Port Macquarie and then came home. And I've got to tell you, there are some incredibly beautiful homes as you're driving down that East Coast. And we were driving along and just looking out of the windows, I found myself going, hey, Joella, look at that one. And then you drive a bit further. Gee, that one's a big house. Look at that. Look at the view that those people would have of the beach. That would have been fantastic. Can you imagine sitting up there in the morning and drinking a coffee? And before I knew it, I actually started to get envious of some of these homes that I saw, some of the lifestyles that I saw in some of these people. Those of you who know me well know that I'm a pretty simple fella. I don't need much to keep me content. I'm not exactly a big liver. But I started to feel that sin of envy just rising up in me as I saw the lifestyles of all of these people having these incredible views of the beach and of the water and all kinds of things. Incredible, incredible. We can fall in the trap of comparison. We can fall in the trap of thinking bigger is somehow more successful or bigger is somehow better. Have a look at what Paul tells the Galatian church here in Galatians chapter 6 from verse 4. Don't compare yourself with others, he says. Pretty blunt. Don't compare yourself with others. Just look at your own work and see if you've done anything to be proud of. You must each accept the responsibilities that are yours. So what does that mean for us? It means we need to avoid the trap of thinking that bigger is better when it comes to church. You see, we're heading into this amazing space, and it would be easy to think, oh, okay, now we've arrived. Look at what we've got. Suddenly it's going to be so much better. But this isn't a big church versus little church debate, because there's room for massive churches. There's room for big churches. There's room for small churches, and there's even room for micro churches in the world. There's room for the whole family of churches. And the goal isn't to grow anyway. I mean, if God chooses to grow our church as we move into the new space, great. We celebrate that. But I think we need to focus on health rather than on growth. We need to focus on how am I tracking with Jesus rather than whether we're getting bigger. You need to focus on how am I tracking with Jesus rather than whether God is adding people to our church. When I read through Paul's letters, I can't see anywhere where he tells the churches to oversee to grow in number. I don't see it, not anywhere. Maybe you can find a verse that tells me about that, but nowhere do I see it. Instead, what does Paul tell the churches that he oversees? He tells them to be great disciples. He tells them to be pure. He tells them to be strong. He tells them to be holy. He tells them to surrender all of themselves to Jesus. He tells them to become like Christ. Here's a couple of examples from Paul's writings. Colossians chapter 1, verse 9. So we've not stopped praying about you since we first heard about you. We ask God to give you complete knowledge of his will and to give you spiritual wisdom and understanding. Then the way you live will always honour and please the Lord, and your lives will produce every kind of good fruit. All the while, you'll grow as you learn to know God better and better. You see, the goal isn't to get big. The goal is to be a great disciple of Jesus. And have a look what he tells the Ephesian church here in Ephesians 6. A final word, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. You see the goal? Bigger is not always better. So let's focus not on the pride we have in the number of people or whether our church is bigger than the church down the road. Let's focus on being the very best disciples of Christ we can be. That's the goal. Second mindset we need to make sure that we've really got nailed down. Beware of judging people. Now, disclaimer, I don't know what the motivations of the two spies were that they ended up at the house of a prostitute. You can fill in the blanks around that all you like. I don't know what was going on there or why they ended up there, and the Bible doesn't tell us. But suffice to say, Rahab was probably way, way, way down the list of people who they thought would be good supporters of their cause. She was probably one of the least likely people that Joshua had in mind when he said, go and scope out Jericho. Probably. Yet, she becomes incredibly supportive. She becomes part of the plan for taking the whole city. She hides the spies, and she becomes this unlikely supporter of the Israelite cause. As we enter into this new space, it's highly likely that we are going to see a real uptick in visitors. It's highly likely we're going to see a whole heap of people start to come in and check out what our church is about. And some of you, or some of them rather, may not be the kind of people that you think should be part of the church family. You might think that they don't fit properly. You might think that they don't know our church culture, or they don't dress right. Or you don't know the bad reputation that that person has in our community. I want to tell you, some of these people might well be Rahabs. They might be people who don't look right at the first glance, but actually become incredibly supportive of the church, or even are just waiting to receive Jesus. Just waiting to receive Jesus. Some of these people will be people who, like Rahab, say, the Lord your God is the supreme God of the heavens above and the earth below. So let's be slow to judge people who come in. Let's be open and let's be accepting of everybody who comes through our doors. Let's welcome them in. Jesus talks about this, doesn't he, in Matthew chapter 7. He says, don't judge others and you won't be judged. For you will be judged as you treat, you'll be treated as you treat others. The standard you use in judging is the standard by which you'll be judged. Gosh, there's a punch to the kidneys. So Jesus, he's giving us this warning about being slow to judge and condemn other people. And do you know what's super surprising about Rahab? This outsider with a bad reputation, she actually ends up becoming part of the Israelite nation. Okay, she gets grafted into the Israelite nation. And do you know she ends up in the lineage of Jesus? She actually ends up in the lineage of Jesus. Have a look at the genealogy at the beginning of Matthew 1 where it unpacks all of the great names of the Bible who end up being part of Jesus' line. Matthew chapter 1 from verse 5, it says, Salmon was the father of Boaz, whose mother was Rahab. Little bit of fantasy in my head. I wonder if Salmon was one of the spies. Bible doesn't say, but how cool would that be? Salmon was the father of Boaz, whose mother was Rahab. Boaz was the father of Obed, whose mother was Ruth. Obed was the father of Jesse, and Jesse was the father of King David. So Rahab is the great, great, great grandmother of King. Is that right? Great, great, great grandmother of King David. How cool is that? And I don't know if there's someone here who's right into the genealogies. You can tell me how many greats there are between Rahab and Jesus. That's your homework, okay? You can figure how many greats there are there. But she ends up in the lineage of our Lord and Saviour. Incredible, incredible. So those people who don't fit, those people with bad reputations and those people with dodgy pasts, they may actually become a crucial part of the Riverland Central family. So let's be super aware of judging others and let's just chuck that out at all costs. And the third mindset we need to get nailed down, and the band can start to come. Trust Christ alone for your salvation. Remember the agreement that Rahab made with the spies? She knew that when the Israelite army attacked her, her people didn't have the slightest chance whatsoever. It was going to be a landslide. They were just going to all get massacred. She'd heard what they'd done in other places, and so she asks for this sign that they would save her when the enemies returned to take the city. They told her to put this scarlet rope in her window, and no one who was inside with her would be harmed. Now, some Bible scholars, some historians believe that the scarlet rope was a sign of her profession. So just like if you can spot a barber's because there's a pole outside, red, white and blue stripes on it, you know that's a barber. If there's a scales hanging from somewhere, you know it's a pawnbroker. In the same way, they believed that, okay, well maybe this scarlet rope was a sign that this was where a prostitute lives, okay? That may be true or it may not. The jury's out on that. But do you know what the scarlet rope really represents? It represents an agreement between Rahab and the spies. It represents an agreement between this single person and a force that is so large it can destroy her. And Rahab learns that she can trust in the agreement that she has made, and the agreement is symbolized by this scarlet rope. Isn't that like us and God? I mean, if you've made an agreement with God, if you've trusted in Jesus, if you've accepted who Jesus is, you've accepted his death for you on the cross, you've accepted his resurrection, you've accepted his ascension, you've said yes to Jesus, you've made an agreement with God. You, an individual, and a force that is so much bigger than you and could destroy you. But the agreement is there, yeah? Quick show of hands. Who's made that agreement? Who's accepted Jesus? Great. If you didn't put your hand up, you need to. You need to accept Jesus. It's the single most significant decision you will ever make. You see, because none of us are going to get out of this life alive. We're all going to die one day, and we're going to come to the end of our lives, and your life is going to be weighed. It's going to be measured. And if you are in Christ, if you have said yes to Jesus, you know, your sins don't get counted against you. Instead, miraculously, wonderfully, the righteousness of Christ is laid upon you, and you get to carry that scarlet rope, as it were. You get to come before God and say, look, I'm in Jesus. Jesus is in me. I've got him. This is the agreement. I've been following Jesus for a whole heap of years now. I first said yes to him when I was 17. So 10 years down the track now, I'm in a really good place with God, you know. But what I've learned over the years is that God is faithful. God is reliable. I can trust in the sacrifice of Jesus. I can trust in the scarlet rope. I can trust that no matter what, God has got my good. And it's not because of anything I've done except say yes and hang on to him. Hang on to that scarlet rope. Have a look what it says, what Paul writes in Ephesians chapter 3. Because of Christ, not because of my own performance, not because of my family, not because of my culture, not because of who I am or what I've done, because of Christ and our faith in him, we can now come boldly and confidently into God's presence. We get to come before the presence of God. And in 1 John, we read, as we live in God, our love grows more perfect. So we'll not be afraid on the day of judgment, but we can face him with confidence because we live like Jesus here in this world. You see, when we look at this amazing building that God has blessed us with, and it is amazing, everyone who comes and goes, you've got that building? As we look at this amazing building, it's extremely tempting to put our trust and our pride in the church. It's extremely tempting to think, well, we've arrived now. And while I'm all for celebrating this extraordinary accomplishment, I'm all for celebrating those incredible people who have sown into this and have grown this, the truth is that the real work is ahead of us. The real work is to grow and to love and to welcome and to endure. And the reality is that one day this building is going to fall down, just like Jericho. Just like everything around us, this building will fall. It'll get burned up. So don't trust the church for your salvation. Love the church, love the people, embrace the crazy organic nature of it and the relationships and the differences and all of that. Enjoy that. Love the church. But understand that your salvation comes from Christ alone. Your salvation comes from Jesus, not from the church. Not from the church. Band, you can come. You can come. So those are our three mindsets that we need to pick up from this portion of the story, this portion of the story of Joshua. Bigger isn't always better. Beware of judging people and trust Christ alone for your salvation. I hope you've got at least one of those mindsets nailed down. I hope that you've got at least one of those thinking, oh yeah, I get that. But I know we're all finite people, right? And there's always new levels in God. There's always new understandings, new ways to change. I bet at least one of those mindsets you go, yeah, I struggle with that. Or I thought I had that nailed down, but you know, a year down the track, 6 months down the track, I'm wrestling with it again. Why don't you stand with me and we're going to pray. And I'm simply going to ask, which of these mindsets do you need to shift? Which of these mindsets do you need to make sure that you've got nailed down? Is it, yeah, I fall for the trap of thinking bigger is somehow more successful. I fall for the trap of somehow thinking bigger is better. You know, God's not particularly interested in size. God's interested in our hearts. He's interested in our hearts. He's much more interested in a healthy church than a big church. What about judgment? Are you pretty big at judging people? Do you immediately start to form judgments on people as you see them and as you meet them? Do you start to immediately build stories that in your head that start to pull people down or that start to dismiss them? I want to tell you, some of the most unlikely people are probably going to become part of our spiritual family in the next generation. And they might even end up in the lineage. Maybe your kids will marry them, you know? You just don't know. You just don't know. What about trusting Christ for your salvation? If you've not ever made the decision to follow Jesus, I want you to do that today. Come and talk to me at the end of the meeting and I'll introduce you to my Savior, Jesus. And for those of us who do follow Christ, it's so easy to put other things in the place of Him. It's so easy to start to shift things. to trust in other things rather than the salvation of Christ. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we want to thank you for this portion of scripture that we've looked at this morning from Joshua. We want to thank you, God, for the way it speaks to us about the mindsets that we need to take on as we enter this new season. I want to pray particularly right now, God, for those who fall in the trap of thinking that bigger is somehow more successful or bigger is somehow better. Lord God, the sin of envy and the sin of comparison is a killer. And so we simply pray now, God, that people will be able to put that stuff to one side and just trust that you've got them no matter what. And Lord, I pray that our focus will be less on being a big church and more on being a healthy church, a church of sold out disciples for you, a church of people, individuals who every aspect of our lives is surrendered to you and comes into line with you and with your values. And Lord God, for those who struggle with judging, those who struggle with judging people, help them to see, God, how restrictive that really can be. Lord, we all need to grow in our welcome of people. We all need to grow in just welcoming people in, understanding that we're all on a journey. We're all growing into the likeness of Jesus. And Lord God, we look forward to seeing in the next season who becomes part of our family, who becomes part of this local church family. And Lord, for those who struggle to trust you for their salvation, Jesus, I pray that you will grow their faith. I pray that you'll grow their sense of risk and boldness, and that they'll choose you, God, even if they don't get it. You know, we don't understand in order to believe. We believe in order to understand. And so, God, grow us up into you, we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. Hey, I hope that's been helpful for you this morning. I hope that as you've grappled with this portion of scripture, God has been unlocking something in your mind. He's been moving something in your mind. We're just going to worship him one more time as we stand, and then we'll break. So let's just worship him together.
I just wanna speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. 'Cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus. I just want to speak the name of Jesus till every dark addiction starts to break, declaring there is hope within, there is freedom. I speak Jesus. 'Cause your name is power. Thank you. every stronghold, shine through the shadows, burn like a fire.
'Cause your name,
'cause your name is power, your name is healing, your name is life. Oh. Break every stronghold, shine through the shadows, burn like a fire. Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy, Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus.
Let's do this, church. We'll shout Jesus from
church and we're seeing in our youth ministry. I can't wait for one day these kids to grow up and for us to be filling that, you know, this building with these young people and, you know, raising up this next generation. So we're preparing the way for these young people to be growing the next generation of believers. And so right now, I just want to also take a moment right now. I've kind of felt bitterness on my heart, but I don't know if any of you have year 12 students in your household or know of anyone, but obviously in our youth group we've got a lot of year 12s going through their exams, and so I just want to take a really quick moment just to pray over them this week. I know there's a lot going on in their lives, so Lord, right now we just lift up all of our year 12s across this state and this nation to you, Lord. We just pray as they go over the next few weeks into their exams that you would give them the strength and the courage to be able to take these on, Lord, that they'd be able to rest in you and abide in you, Lord, that they'd be able to continue to follow you and to pursue more of you even through these difficult and tough times, Lord. May you be with them throughout these weeks and that they may be able to come out the other side stronger and closer to you, Lord. In your name we pray, amen. I also, on our screens, we have our giving details. There they are, our giving details. So if you want to sow into the ministry of this church, if you want to give towards our building offerings or even just your tithes and offerings, there's the details up there. We also have our giving stations. There's one at the back of the room here, and then there's one in the overflow room on the wall
If you don't know where one is, just find someone who looks like they know where one is and ask them. If all else fails, ask Pastor Dave. Ask me, I will help you find them. Yes, anyway, have a blessed week and enjoy some cake and coffee and get to know one another.
God is great.